That was my first hurdle. I've managed to get over that. I have, on the record, been razor clam fishing in the west of Ireland, and I knew about the sole before you said it. So I came back with big buckets of those, and I made nice soup, actually, when I was about eight. I've come here today not to talk about razor clam fishing, but to talk about CourseMart. I'm new to the education business. I joined CourseMart about 6 months ago, 8 months ago, to set up their international activities. But up until then, I've been working in the whole digital arena for about 20 years, and having recently set up all Random House's digital activities across ebooks and apps and all that sort of stuff. And before that, I was in the record business. So I wanted to talk to you about CourseMart. And we've got some fast facts up here. The main thing that most people know about CourseMart is it's actually owned by the major academic publishers. It was set up in 2006 by a collaboration of them. They're all up there. And those companies are working with me to roll it out internationally. In 2006, ebooks were very new. And it was one of the first platforms to do digital. But we have evolved the platform, and I'm going to tell you quite a lot about that. And CourseMart is now the largest provider of e-textbooks globally, and mainly in the US at the moment, predominantly in the US at the moment, 2.5 million users, 20,000 e-textbooks up there. And it's essentially an e-commerce rental model for students and a sampling model for faculty. We're experiencing, along with many other people in digital, we're experiencing very rapid growth at the moment. And we set up the international office last year. So, you know, people have talked a lot today around what students have and the technology that's out there, so I'm not going to go on and on about this. But safe to say that this is a very common scene that we see. Students on various devices, remotely accessing, using Wi-Fi, using 3G, coming into 4G. There is really no problem with students on technology. And this is partly why CourseMart was set up. But, you know, there's been a lot of discussion today in this fascinating conference around what's actually happening in the specific area of digital learning with students. And while students and consumers generally are very keen to take up technology in other aspects of their life, we haven't seen them using ebooks in great numbers in the UK. In the US, from what I hear talking to my colleagues, we really are now beginning to see that digital shift happening. And a lot of that seems to be being driven by tablets, actually. This comes from a Pearson Foundation study, which they did last year, or early this year, talking around tablet ownership and how that's growing very, very quickly. And students believe that tablets will transform the way they learn. And this was the year, in this particular study, that they said that digital was preferable for them instead of physical. And looking again at the overall US market, as Kate mentioned earlier, the ad sales forecasts, we are seeing very bullish forecasts for the overall use of digital course materials in the US. That transition is really happening. But in the UK, as has been mentioned quite a lot earlier on, we're seeing that students are online in their normal lives. We're seeing they're online using Wikipedia, although that might be declining. They're using journals, they're using digital resources in their libraries and on their networks, but they aren't using ebooks in great numbers. And the question really for all of us here is why is that so? And one of the reasons that I've come to, coming new to education, one of the things that I would observe is that, you know, in contrast with consumer ebooks, which don't have, in the main, fiction, narrative non-fiction, don't have complex page layouts, there is this issue of the page layout, which is essential to the pedagogy of a complex textbook. And it's hard to digitize this. It's hard to display it. Graham is going to talk about EPUB 3 in a minute and talk about how we can display complex books. And it's hard to distribute. The distribution channel for complex books doesn't exist yet in a mass market kind of way. The second point is that, as has been alluded to a lot earlier on, the sales chain is complex. It's adoption driven and has many players all interlinking with each other, which adds to the inertia that we see. It's got a sales team from the publisher, the faculty selling to the faculty or the institution. The bookshop is also involved and the students in there too. And there's a lot of push-pull going along with technological trends being pulled from the student, being pushed maybe from the publishers, but everybody has to be equally engaged for the whole thing to move forwards. And it has been mentioned earlier, faculty are slow to change. And they are, all our research says that although we're seeing other peer-to-peer groups coming through, they are at this point in time important influencers, particularly when students are new to the learning environment. And I don't know if people have seen the BML excellent study on this, but they've charted students' attitudes and approaches as they progress through university. And in their first year in particular, they're very influenced by what the professor says they need to do. So in this environment, we're seeing that they are surprisingly slow to change. And of course, it is all around learning outcomes. It's not about and pushing digital for the sake of it. This is around trying to find a way of pushing digital for a better learning outcome, using digital for a better learning outcome. And this is where CourseMonth comes in. So I'm going to run a little bit through what CourseMonth does. In Kate Warlock's terms, we are books underneath glass. It is a starting position, Kate, and hopefully we'll get something more sophisticated as the world moves with us. But this is the kind of glass you can view CourseMonth under. All kinds of tablets, smartphones, and also on any web-enabled device. So the first thing, the second thing actually on my point here, but the first thing to know about CourseMonth is that it's a universal accessible system. You can go onto your CourseMonth account from any web-enabled device. It's account-based. Any device with a web browser, even a Kindle Fire, you can look at your CourseMonth ebooks on that. But the first point in this slide is that we also, as we've been set up by higher ed publishers, we took a holistic approach to the industry, and we have offering for everybody, for publishers and their sales teams. We run this digital sampling platform. For faculty, well, we run the digital sampling platform as well, because the faculty are able to access to the platform, have a look at any book on the platform if they have instant access. For students, I'll talk about this in a minute, we have the e-commerce platform, and bookstores can also link up with CourseMonth. In fact, in the US, a third of our sales come through bookshops. Jumping through the third point here, it's an ebook platform which has been designed with the requirements of the higher ed business in mind. We've got appropriate DRM, so it's online access only, one simultaneous user. We have territorial controls we've built into the international model. You can take notes, you can bookmark, you can highlight, you can print, and you can copy, and these are all things that the students really wanted to see. And these are utilitarian things that they can use inside the platform, and the platform brings them value out from that point of view. And also, again, it is page fidelity with print, so you can use the book alongside, sitting beside somebody else who's using the printed book, and you have page fidelity. And this, at this point in time, in the evolution of textbooks, of digital learning, this is an important feature. And not spoken about much today yet, potentially later, it's optimized for accessibility, so anybody who's visually disabled, we can use screen readers with the textbooks, and that makes them accessible. The student rental model, which we will be launching, which we announced at the London Book Fair, which will be going live some point in the next couple of weeks for international markets, for the UK and Europe, is attractively priced versus print. And this is for two reasons, the main reason of which is that it's a rental access. So the pricing that you will see on the CourseMonth site when it goes live, is that books are up to 40% off for a rental period, for rental access, and that could be about 180 days. And that's by comparison to the physical purchase price. The last two points I wanted to make around CourseMonth on this particular point is that we also provide a much-needed marketplace for higher ed textbook and e-resources for students. We also pull together the e-resources that have been discussed earlier on today. We bring them all together, merchandise them, in a place where the student can easily find them, easily search through our database and stuff, and they can find out if there is an accompanying e-resource or a My iLab or whatever which goes with the textbook or which potentially is a replacement for the textbook. So they're able to find all these things all in one place, and that marketplace is not there at the moment. And finally on this slide, we also do integrations with all the VLEs or LMS systems, and we are able to work with institutions to facilitate institutional selling using that kind of integration. So I just wanted to recap around the kinds of people who would be using our system and what they'd be using it for to help you understand. So as I said, for publishers, it's a sampling platform which they can use to support the activities of their sales teams. It gives them extensive reach into further flung territories and reduces the cost and also the green factor, if you like, of printing books, shipping them all over the world and having them potentially sitting on shelves and not being used. For students, it's a cost-effective place for them to go and rent digital books, rent access to digital books, and where they can find everything all in one place. For faculty and instructors, it's free instant access for a cross-publisher system which is tailored to their needs and from which they can email students directly. And for bookstores, if they work with us, we have a number of different models, it's an online textbook solution to work with bookstores. So really, CourseMonth was developed in order to address the needs of the general higher ed business in all its facets. So finally, on these sort of detail slides, I just want to talk a little bit about our international plans, because I know many of you will be interested in this. So we went live with our sampling platform back in March, and the country focus for that is the UK, Scandinavian, Benelux, but it reaches out into another 40 or so countries around Europe. The site is, the activity is centred around the .co.uk website, so it's the .co.uk, coursemod.co.uk website. It's an, for English language books and English language e-resources and English interface, although we are reaching out into many other territories. And the e-commerce site is going live in the next couple of weeks. So before I got to talking a little bit around the future, I just wanted to highlight a couple of features. This is unusual to show some of the features of the site, but in order to bring some of the functionality home, I just wanted to run through a couple of slides with people. So everybody's used to looking at search engines, search windows, but the faculty instant access feature works in a very powerful way. So once an instructor in an institution has been authenticated by a number of publishers and has what we call faculty instant access, they're able to search through the database of all of the e-textbooks which are up there and instantly get access, so they can look at that book. And they can look at that book for the duration of the rental period. This is really a very powerful tool for discoverability for instructors, for all publishers who are on the platform. And something I didn't mention earlier on is that in the US we now have over 30 publishers on our platform, so the platform is open to all publishers in the marketplace. All the things that you can do on a normal e-commerce platform you can do here, but one thing I hadn't mentioned earlier, you can also read offline, so you can download and cache the books, so you can take them with you. If you're going to an area which is remote and not online, you can download them and cache them. And so the reader, just briefly, we've spoken a lot around how this is the page image, but there's a lot of functionality around the page image of the book which has been built in, including search and all kinds of visual displays. So you can select a view, you can turn the page, you can do a continuous scroll, you can look at double page, you can page compare one book to the other, you can do a thumbnail view. And so there are lots of different ways of looking at the books inside the platform. You can search, you can navigate by table of contents, you can navigate by keyword and all kinds of highlighting. And search is one of the things that students say they really, really like with these very big textbooks. They can do page number, which is important for page fidelity. And also there's all kinds of zooming and things that you would expect to see, zooming in very close on something. This is note-taking, so you can copy your notes out, and you can keep them separately, you can print them, you can copy them out into a Word document. So students and sales reps use these in order to keep notes they can navigate through a book. So you format your notes, you can make them ready for whatever use you're going to use to them. Print them, that's more note-taking, bookmarking, and printing. And the other thing to say around printing is that printing is something which is quite emotional for publishers. They don't like to see that they have a digital book which is available for print. But in the US market, it's very, very important for students to know that they are able to print. And within CourseSmart, you can print up to 10 pages at a time. So you have to go to a specific print function, you pick the 10 pages you want to print, you print them out, and when they are printed, they have a watermark from the person whose account that is. So it's quite secure in the sense that if they were then to be photocopied and passed around, it would be possible to see whose account they had come from. At the same time, you can print quite a significant portion of the book in those 10-page sections. And students find that to be incredibly useful functionality. Reviewing notes, etc., etc. So I just wanted to talk a little bit around, and I think it's been a very, very interesting morning. And the whole education space is really, really opening out, and there's so many different things that are happening, from looking at social learning through to the role of the institution and the VLEs and all the different things that are happening. I just wanted to make some kind of overview comments on that. And you know, in my view, again, there are three main players involved here who all need to be engaged and who are all engaging with different motivations and different speeds in this whole transition that's taking place in the higher ed sector. The publishers are engaging in the first instance with just digitising their books, which is actually quite an achievement. Getting the books into digital form, getting all the metadata in a form, looking at EPUB 3 and all the future of those things, the new layouts and interactive books and all those things that are coming through. So they're digitising their books and they're looking at added functionality and utility that they can add. And they're also looking at e-resources and websites and apps and all those different things. But the faculty also needs to engage too, and the faculty is engaging, and we're discussing in the UK now with some very innovative faculty who are running pilot programs and using iPads, etc., etc., all interested in pulling forward what specifically you can use digital for to improve the learning outcome and to for other things, integrating with VLEs, etc., and bringing costs down. And we're part of the last bit, which is the channel engaging. So we are the channel, which is the much-needed marketplace, which brings things to people in an easy way to find, a one-click purchase, which gives them customer support, which gives them the ability to select across the whole marketplace and see what it is that they want to find. And that's part of what we're doing here. And as everybody engages and as technology constantly changes and the whole thing moves forwards, well, then I expect that we'll see a huge amount of change in this sector over the next 18 months to 3 years, and students will engage. So that was all I had to say. Thank you very much.
We've largely finished in time, so we have some questions. Let's start over here, please. Can you say your name and your institution?
I'm Anna Sampson from the University of Westminster.
No?
Not right.
I can hear you.
The one group that you didn't mention in that presentation was libraries and librarians. And I'm really interested to how you think this is actually going to be adopted in the UK, because my personal experience from our institution, and also from talking to the publishers, is that students are not expecting to buy this content. They're expecting the library to pay for it. They're expecting it to be included in this £9,000, which, although to them is more money, it doesn't represent more money for the university. Yep. It's just a redistribution of income. So the library's not going to have any more money. As soon as you talk to faculty about these e-books, they come to the library to ask us to get them or to explain to them what this means, how they acquire them. And I'm not really sure what my question is, other than how do you actually envisage that this is going to work?
Yep.
We are being told by students that they expect us to provide the content for them, and there's no way that you can buy on the basis of buying copy for every student.
Yep. Well, I mean, the way that we would work with an institution would be for an institutional purchase. What we're able to bring to that is we can integrate with a VLE or with an institution in another way and allow the institution to then deliver securely single student access for each student access into that book. So they're able to do bulk purchasing through the CourseWatch system. And that's something that we're seeing happening a lot now in the US. But very often it's not the library which is making the purchase, it's a different part of the institution which is making the purchase.
I'm just curious because I think if a department comes to us and asks us to get something, if we suggest to them that they might have money within the department to pay for that, they're coming to the library, and the model is not geared up in a reasonable way that the library can afford to even countenance purchase, because we just can't buy on that basis.
Yeah. I mean, there are a lot of ebook aggregators that work with libraries, and they have all kinds of different models. So what we're bringing is a different way of doing that. But it is, our way is account based. It is individual account based. So there is a big discount to the student versus buying the physical book in the rental model, and also we're able to apply that model into a bulk sale model too. But you know, as to where the funds come from, I mean, I'm not actually able to answer that question.
But it's absolutely crucial. Who holds that budget, and who can release the money? That's absolutely right.
Yeah.
And certainly the departments wouldn't be able to pay.
No, neither
would the library.
John, you had a question for me? Well, actually, it was a very similar question, really. Can you enable institutional purchasing if, say, an institution have the money to do, or a course?
Yeah.
Private
course. I mean, we are able to, and the way we work, the way we facilitate that is through redemption code. So what we would do is we are able to do that. So if a library wanted to buy, or an institution wanted to buy, for example, 100 copies of a book, we issue 100 redemption codes, and we allocate those against individual accounts, and then that student then gets the redemption code either has an account or opens a new account, and then they just get access to the book for the period.
I think the who pays issue is maybe something we try and pick up at the panel session later on.
Yeah. I think it's a very good issue.
The role of educational technology people. Yeah.
Okay, one last question, then we'll move on.
Just SuperNet University of Morgan. Got a redemption code. Presumably, those would have considerably less than the standard fee for a digital textbook or print textbook. Because if the access is so very restricted, you don't have anything to go to. The user doesn't have anything to carry on to use in the future. It's time limited. It seems a very narrow way of delivering.
Yeah.
So I would expect that very narrow way of delivering. Which
means
very, very much less in cost.
The pricing, which is set by the publisher, so the way cost might work is as we provide a marketplace, and the publishers will set the pricing. So the pricing, the publisher will set the price for the book for the different rental periods that they can offer. So they can offer maybe a 180-day rental period, or a 360-day rental period, or even longer if they wish. So that's really up to the publisher. But if you look on the US website, you'll see that publishers are offering up to 60% off for a digital rental. I think the other point to make is that the course model is based on the individual user, and it's also based on individual usability. So all the notes and the personalization that the student would do inside a textbook, which is part of their core learning, are things that you can do in your own account in the course smart model. So in contrast to something which might be available for universal access, they do have their own private area that they go to, which is their own account and their own bookshelf, where they can keep everything that they have to do with that particular course.
But they still pay 40% for something they have to pay for a
sample period. I can't comment on the if it were 40% off, they would be renting the book for that period of time, and that would be instead of purchasing the book. So, you know, what we're offering here is another choice for students. So if they choose to not purchase it, they can choose to rent it digitally. But, you know, they can also choose to find some other way of getting access to it as well.
Let's turn to that then, perhaps in the afternoon. No, thank you very much.